Thank you, brothers and sisters. What a privilege to be here. And you know, I suddenly discovered that if somebody asks you for your testimony and how the Lord changed your personal life, it's something that it shifted to the back burner in my life. So I'm so glad for giving me this subject. And I just wonder, how much does your personal testimony and the road and the way that you're walking with God, it's part, an integral part of your testimony and your preaching and your ministry. I can't speak about what happened in my personal life without saying that it was not me, it's God. To Him all the glory. It's absolutely a privilege for me to be here with you. You know, it's not easy to be a Reformed pastor speaking to what shall we say, unreformed people. For a long time in my life, I grew up, I grew up here actually in the Moot, in Wonderboom site, in Voortrekker Street. Went to Wonderboom High, and I've been growing up in a tradition where nobody said it, but I just became aware that the Dutch Reformed people are actually the only ones who are really in the truth. That sinful attitude grew in my life, looking down on people not being part of the Reformed tradition. Then in Standard 9, my second eldest daughter became very sick with liver cancer. And in that time, the Lord really changed many things in our lives. The doctors said that prognosis that she won't live 2-3 months, and a battle started for 18 months before the Lord came to fetch her. But if I look back at that time, many things you can't understand, but one thing that I can see that the Lord did was to break down church dividing walls. It was the people of the unreformed churches who, more than others, reached out and comforted us. Come and pray for my child. Come and encourage us. And suddenly I discovered in the charismatic world, in the Pentecostal world, friends and brothers in Christ. And I also discovered that the Lord Jesus isn't actually in here. And His whole ministry has been open, loving people, as we also had this song, reaching out to people without the dividing walls that we see and that we create. So it's a wonderful privilege speaking in an ecumenical meeting like this, and hoping in my heart that the Lord will create in the Moot, over dividing walls, a unity and a working together and a love for one another and a forward going with the Lord as our leader, obeying Him above everything else. Now, I've been asked to say something about my testimony, and there are actually two episodes that I want to open up a little bit. The first one is my battle around assurance of salvation. Yes, I told you that I grew up in the Moot, and in those times, nobody in the Moot spoke English in that time. So, now why did I say that? But I had a battle in my heart to know what will happen if I die. I had a struggle in myself knowing, is it really, can you know here on earth already what is in the books of heaven? If your name is written in God's book, can you absolutely be sure about it? I remember many evenings going out, standing here under the moored sky, starry sky line, and just asking God, today I feel I'm your child, but I'm not sure. How can I be sure? Another time I would stand there and I would call out to God and say, God, I'm sure I'm not your child. I'm so sorry what I've done. And eventually the problem was, I never knew when was I right. Being assured, yes, I think I'll go to heaven, or when I felt I won't make it. And with that insecurity in my spiritual life, I really didn't grow. And well, as I said here in the Moord, I also received my call for full-time ministry. What happened is that perhaps not going there, it's a long story, but the Lord, I was sure that the Lord wants me to give my life full-time to Him. And I started that journey, studying here in Pretoria, then went into Stellenbosch. Things came to a point when I came to the, I was fourth year theological studies, and I was more educated in theology, I believe, than the other people in my hostel, and I was a Bible study leader, and very subtle, I thought, I'm not only in here, but I'm also a little bit higher than these other uneducated students around me. But then one night, during the Bible study where I was the leader, someone in the group asked, can one be 100% sure here on earth, if you die, you'll go to heaven? Suddenly it struck me that this is the question that I can't answer, and it's going to show them that I'm not so high and mighty in my spiritual life, that I actually am a baby in my spiritual growth. So I thought, well, the best thing now to do is to ask this question to them. I said, this is a very good question. Sort of, I know the answer, but I'm not going to tell you. Let's hear what you say. And I thought, listening to their answers, I would make up the right answer. But I can tell you, the more they discussed this question, the more confused I became. Someone said, you can't be so arrogant and full of yourself and say you are going to heaven. No, said another guy, you better know that, because you don't know when the Lord is coming to take you. I read in the Bible, I know it's in Luke 16 now, that you can't change after you die. Jesus told a story, and He won't mislead anybody. So the truth is that both of Lazarus and the rich man died simultaneously. The one went to heaven, and the other to the place of torment and fire and the wrath of God. And this rich man cried in the fiery flames, I see over this chasm, I see over this gap, there is heaven, and I see Lazarus is there. Can't he bring some water and just relieve this pain of this fire in my heart? It wasn't a physical fire. And eventually, the explanation came that you can't, if you die, you're either in heaven or in hell. And you can't. The one can't go to the other side, and these can't come to this side to come and relieve your pain. So he said, you must be sure. The other one said, well, suppose, he said, it's arrogant to think God will show you already what is in his books. The Bible teaches us to wait until the day that God came again and the day of judgment come. Then you'll see what is the truth when he opens the books. Then a guy said, suppose he opened the books and my name is not there. What then? Then it's too late to discover that. Another guy said, I read a story about the martyrs that they died for their belief in Jesus. And they were so sure that they'll go to heaven that they went over with joy and with praise in their hearts. So it seems to them that some say no and some say yes. You can be sure, you must be sure. And today I know that because I haven't had that assurance in my life, I never told somebody, anybody, that I'm a Christian. Because I wasn't sure. Is this a lie? Is it the truth? So I made another plan, you know. Today I know the battle was this old nature in me. Didn't want to die. So I keep my face and I told them, okay, I can see you don't know the answer. But I'm not going to tell you today. I'll tell you next week. Go and battle it out in your struggle in your own personal life. That would do good. Having the plan in the back of my head that I'll go and find out. And they'll never know that I also didn't have any assurance in my life. So, first class that I thought this professor would give me the right answer. And I asked him in the class, and then he started to explain in the highest theological terms things about predestination and before the... Okay, any case, I was so more confused after he explained that I decided, no, I'm rather going not to make a fool of myself asking such questions in the class again. I'll go to the library, and there I will find a book that can explain it. And for the rest of that week, before the next Bible study group meeting, I stayed in the library without any success. But let's jump to the Tuesday before the Wednesday that we had the Bible study group. That Tuesday, I closed my door, put off the light. I was in a single room, and I started to pray on my knees next to my bed, and I said, Lord, I won't leave this place, and I won't stand up from my knees until you have spoken to me. You promise that if we ask, you will hear. If we knock, you will open. If we pray, you will answer. Now I stand on your word. Give me the answer. I must give it tomorrow to the people in my group. As I stood there on my knees, waiting on the Lord, I heard nothing except, you better confess and tell them you didn't know. You better confess the pride in your heart. So it was a shocker for me to discover that I got a spiritual problem, and that I am already fourth year theological studies, and the Lord says there's something wrong in your heart. But I was in such a state to give the right answer. I said, Lord, okay, I will go tomorrow, and I'll confess that I was phony. I didn't speak the truth. I didn't tell you that I was in the same struggle as all of you. I didn't know. But Lord, I can't leave them there. I'm the Bible study leader. I must help them to get assurance of salvation. So I'll go and confess. But before that, you must give me the right answer. Okay, I thought the answer would be in another theological book, Bavink, Berghauer, whatever, Barth, Bullinger, Bonhoeffer, what else you want? All those books didn't help me. Went back late for dinner. No, it was lunch. When I came in the dinner place where we all the tables were set and taken, except one table was open. Usually it was open because the foreign students sat there, and they were all atheists. And if you're a theological student, especially, you don't want to sit there. And it happened again. I sat there. Luckily, Louis, he was a teacher. And I got a calling to go full-time for the Lord. And he was a mature Christian and sorted out in his spiritual life. And they started to tackle us. And they said, "Ah, did God speak to you today? Did you see God? What did he say to you? Did he perhaps tell you something? Did he perhaps tell you you'll go to heaven? Or did he tell you you'll go to hell?" I sat there shocked, with my mouth full of teeth. I couldn't say a word. But Louis said, "Well, guys, I can tell you God speaks to me every day. I know his voice, and he already told me that if I die, I'll go to heaven." And when he said that, he stood up and he walked out. I wasn't done with my food, but then I lost my appetite and I ran after trying to ask him, "Louis, you said those guys well, eh? Did you really mean it, or you just for argument's sake did it?" "Oh, I'm sure." "How can you be sure? Can man one be sure? This side of the grave, or this side before the Lord come and fetch you?" "Yes, you must be sure." I say, "How can you say that? Come to my room, I'll show you." Then what he did, he just gave the Bible in my hands and he said, "Read 1 John 5:30. I am writing this to you so that you may know that you have eternal life, you that believe in the Son of God." So he asked me, "Why is scripture written?" I said, "Well, that we may know that we have eternal life, that we will have eternal life one time in the future." No, that we have eternal life. So he said, I asked him now, "Okay, so the Bible said you must be sure. God wants his children to be sure. God wants his children to know that they belong to his family and to the Heavenly Father. But how can we know that?" He said, "Read the previous verse. Whoever has the Son has this life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life." "We've got eternal life." I say, "Well, scripture says he who has the Son. Who goes to hell? Those who does not have the Son of God." And suddenly the light broke through in my heart, because I knew that I had many times been on my knees asking the Lord to give assurance that he will take my sin. And I confessed it again and again and again. But suddenly I discovered that scripture says, if you accepted Jesus, you're his child. And something new happened in your life. That is what I know today, is being born again by God's Spirit as a child of the Father, being born out of him, now living through his Spirit. And the Spirit will tell you, "Abba, Father." Call God your Father. You are his child. And now he'll help you to understand that what God says in his word is the truth. Since that day, I got the assurance that God said it to me. It's not only written in the Bible. God said it to me, you have eternal life. I knew that I opened my heart and I asked Jesus, and Revelation 3:20 says, if you open your heart and ask Jesus to come in your life, he will come in. So he didn't play and ran away. He came in. So I must take God on his word. He is in my life. He's taken my sins away. He stays in my heart. I've got a son, and therefore I've got eternal life already. With that assurance, many things changed in my life. I went back to the Bible study group. I can't wait to be there that evening, telling them I had to die on myself. I had to take up my cross if I want to follow Jesus. And that's not easy. And I want to confess that I thought I was better than you, and pride was a problem in my life. And since then I know that this temptation won't disappear. It's an ongoing battle. Sometimes even when I preach, a little voice tell me, you know, you're good. You're doing well. And then the Lord shows me somebody who's busy sleeping. And then I said, okay, God, I can't take control again. It's not me, it's you. Since then, I started to tell people that I'm sure. And ask them, are you sure? And discovered that the most important calling of us Christians is to ask people if they've got assurance of salvation and if they are ready to meet the Lord. Do we still do it? Do you? When last have you done it? There are people in our homes, at work, around us, that the Lord will give a little nudge and say, are you sure he'll go to heaven? Do you think you've got assurance? Ask him. The second thing that really changed my life after discovering the assurance of salvation is what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, in my tradition that I grew up, I didn't learn a lot about the Holy Spirit. I was looking around, asking around. But during my student days here in Pretoria, I worked during holidays and vacations. I worked at the municipality. And, there was a guy that asked me about the Holy Spirit. And he told me wonderful things about the Holy Spirit. And that made me curious because I didn't know what he is speaking about. Today I know some of the things scared me a little bit. Some things were a little bit weird. You know, he told me how they catch on Friday nights in the tent, how they catch the Holy Spirit. Very loud and very sailing on the ground and doing funny things. After that, the next holiday, I met another guy where I worked as a waiter on the Blue Train. And this guy, also full of the Spirit, told me wonderful things. Funny things, that they have a picture of the Holy Spirit taken in one of their services and things like that. But so eventually I was so confused because I haven't got the truth in my heart. And I started searching. Eventually I wrote my dissertation, my theological dissertation on baptism and fulfillment of the Holy Spirit. I've been seeking, what is this? And I couldn't find answers. Since then, I've been on this journey, and I just felt, after getting peace in my own heart, to write this in Afrikaans, and it's been translated in English. And I brought those books, it's at the back there, with Charlene. You can buy them or bring your card after the service here. They are thin ones and they are thicker ones, and telling the story, but actually what scripture says. Because eventually I had to make sure that what does the Bible teach us about the Holy Spirit? Not this community or those people or this group. What does God says in His Word? What is the truth about being filled or being baptized with the Holy Spirit? So my prayer is that that book will still keep on helping people. It's been, I think, through 11 editions. There's a need for this. People in the Afrikaans and Reformed tradition got a hunger in their hearts to know more about the gifts of the Spirit. What does it mean to speak in tongues? The gift of healing, the gift of a word of wisdom, of knowledge, of discernment. What does it mean to prophesy? So I would encourage you to read and to make an effort to know more about what God says about the Holy Spirit. Because when He left, He said, this dispensation has been the Father until the Son of God, Jesus, was born. And when He ascended to heaven, the new dispensation started till the second coming. And that is the dispensation of the Holy Spirit, of God, the third person in the Trinity. I will be with you. I will come and stay in you. I will be a reality. I'll talk to you. I'll lead you. I'll work through you. I'll do wonders through you, miracles. Not you, but me through you. Now, just to say a little bit, what happened is eventually I ended up in my, I think my fifth year studies, at the evening where a pastor or he asked in the devotions that evening, I want you to stand up, everyone who is 100% sure that he is, I thought he said sure of his salvation. I was ready to stand up, but he said something else. I want you to stand up if you are 100% sure that you are filled with the Holy Spirit. I looked around, there was confusion even in my heart. Four guys stood up at the back, and then the preacher said, those four are the only four people that are in the will of God. Now, you know this pride thing. I went to the pastor after the service and tried to explain him, he haven't got it right. His theology is a little rusted and old, and I can tell him now right out of the theological school what he need to know. You see the battle with those arrogant, pride, self, full of yourself. That's why Jesus said, you want to follow me, you must die in yourself. Take up your cross daily. Now, then he also explained afterwards that, you see, what does the Bible teach us on being filled with the Holy Spirit? Ephesians 5:18 says, do not get drunk with wine, which will only ruin you. That's what drunkenness do. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Become intoxicated by the Spirit. Come under the influence, not of alcohol, but of the Spirit, of God. He said, is that scripture, is that a command or not? I said, yes, that's a command. There it says, be filled with the Spirit. He said, if you are not obeying a command of God, are you in His will? I said, no. That night I battled with the Lord, because I discovered that I'm not so good and so in the center of God's will with my spiritual life. And God revealed to me there's something lacking in my spiritual life. And that is the control and the life that He wants to live through me. I went that next morning, couldn't sleep well. I went early that morning, sitting there in Beinskloof, there on top of the mountain. There was a little brook. I sat next to it and I said, okay, I'll just ask the Holy Spirit to fill me and then I can go back. When I said it, Holy Spirit, take control of my life, something broke open in my heart. A voice came up and said, you must not say that. If you say God must come and take total control of your life, He will take all the joy out of your life. You'll never laugh again. And I saw this gruesome picture of monks in caves with not talking to each other, only reading the Bible, and no joy. Miserable life. And I said, Lord, you know my heart. But I want to be filled with the Spirit. If I must go to Morocco, I'll go in that caves and stay there. But I want to be filled with the Spirit. Then that voice came back again. Don't say that. If you say that, God will tell you to stay on your own like Paul and never marry. I cried and I was so sorry for myself not being able to love a woman ever. And I decided eventually, okay, I'll go back and I'll tell this girl that I really love, sorry, I made a choice between you and the Lord and you came second. So I eventually said, Lord, if I must be on my own alone, poor me, without the love of a woman, you are the most important in my life. Just come and take control. Holy Spirit, fill me on my life. The moment I said it, that voice came back again and he said, if you say that and mean it, God will send you to China. And I had a fear in my heart for China. My best friend, Toby de Wet, he was so excited to go to Japan. It's a long story, but I went to him one day and I want to ask him, why do people come to you and ask you to help them to get forgiveness of sins? Why don't they come to me? And I knew it's because he's willing to do everything. He'll go to Japan. Well, I'll not do that. And I've been confronted there. While the sun was shining hot on me, and I eventually said, Lord, if it might be China, wherever you want to send me, I'll go. And then the peace of the Lord came over me, and the assurance that God heard my voice. Just a little bit news, in brackets, yawn. When I finished my studies, I got two callings, one to Windhoek and one to Riviera. And it was clear for me, my family is in Pretoria, there I'll go. And suddenly, I couldn't get peace until I said, Lord, okay, I'll go to China. And I had 7 wonderful years in Windhoek, such a fruitful ministry there, knowing that I'm in the will of God. So my first congregation where I went was Graaf Reinet under the students. And when I came there, I were very excited the first day to go to a hostel and all the faces and the students sat there and I saw and I knew all of them are not right with God. And I made afterwards to ask them if anyone is not sure about His salvation and going to heaven, please stay. I just want to pray for you. And all of them went out. Nobody came back. I went on my knees and asked the Lord, please, what's wrong? What is missing? What is lacking in my ministry? Eventually, God heard that prayer when we had a camp on a farmer's there outside on a farm. And I spoke about what Scripture teaches us about the Holy Spirit, and I gave them the opportunity in small groups to pray. And the Holy Spirit came and took control of their lives. They went back to their friends and to the schools, and suddenly there was revival because of of people being filled with the Spirit and the Spirit doing wonderful things through them. They called me to one or two or three of that hostels. Here are some students that want to speak to you. When I opened the door and the first one went out, I saw a queue round the corner. I couldn't believe that's not me. And when they came in, they were under so conviction about their sins. They just confessed, and we prayed and asked Jesus to come and take control. And it happened. And there was a snowball effect out of that. Today, I just want to encourage you. Ask the Lord Jesus to fill you with His Holy Spirit. Or are you not sure that the Spirit of God has a contract with you that you really mean to obey Him and to let Him have His will and His way through you? Are you sure He is in control? 100%. Or are there some things that you keep back? As I had three things that the Lord confronted me about my joy in the world. I know the fruit of the Spirit is joy, happiness, being friendly. But that time I didn't know it. I had a problem with the world. I had a problem with a personal relationship with the opposite sex. I had a problem with being willing to walk out of my comfort zone. So this is my question. Are you sure that you are filled with the Holy Spirit? I'll come back to those three questions, but let's pray together. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank You that You really loves us. You love us so much that You gave Your life on the cross of Calvary for our sins. You paid our penalty. You want to heal our hearts, to cleanse in our lives, to make us new. We want to ask You, come and give us that assurance again. Help us to be honest with You. And Holy Spirit, help us to give the control totally over to You. Lord, we want to be 100% consecrated to You. We want to trust You, who said, will a father give a stone when you ask bread? How much more will I give the Holy Spirit if you ask? Lord, we want to make a new contract. We want to stay with that contract. A covenant to daily took up our cross. A covenant to follow You. To let You take the control of our life. Come, Holy Spirit. We asked it right in the beginning of our worship. Let us see the new life that You meant for us. In the power of Your Spirit, through the working of Your gifts, a miraculous, supernatural life, not out of ourselves, not playing religion, but being an instrument for You to work through. Thank You, Holy Spirit, that we know that if we ask You to take control, You do this for us. You even do it now. And if there are some things that keep us back, show us. And don't leave us until we obey. Thank you, Jesus, that we can look forward under your control to see how a new wind will blow over the moor, to see the grass moving and getting and changing into ripe grain, fruitful trees. Come and bless your children, your servants. In Jesus' name, amen.